हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू माय थर्ड लेक्चर ऑन कुलकर्णी चालुक्य यूट्यूब चैनल। होप यू हैव ऑलरेडी वॉच्ड माय अर्लियर वीडियोस ऑन ड्रीम ऑफ माया देवी एंड आल्सो दी नरसिम्हा अर्ली नरसिम्हा स्कल्पचर्स फ्रॉम कर्नाटका। दिस चैनल एज आई हैव बीन टेलिंग यू इज नॉट अ कमर्शियल चैनल, इट्स ओनली विथ माय पर्सनल इंटरेस्ट एंड इंटरेस्ट इन रिसर्च, interest in inculcating the Indian art history as it is through its objective the developments and also the informations. And all these lectures are based on my personal research and also repeated visits to the site and the documentation that I have been doing from last 2.5 decades are being summed up in a nutshell in different lectures which I have been planning, and of course I will be try to the post at least once a week one lecture. Today's lecture is about the mural tradition in Karnataka, especially the mural paintings during the Vijayanagara dynasty. As the history speaks about, is one of the very important phase of the Indian history, especially in connection with the southern India. So the Vijayanagara dynasty established in the year 1336 and was very active till mid 16th century. The four families ruled the dynasty, and the third one, which is a very important from the point of art and architecture, the Tuluva dynasty, in which the well-known King Krishnadevaraya ruled from 1509 to 1529, followed by his younger brother Achyutaraya, and subsequently after 1542 the Tuluva dynasty, the rule has been shifted to the Aravidu, the last the recognized ruling family of the Vijayanagara dynasty. So the major activities happened during the time of Krishnadevaraya. As we know that he was also called Tri Samudra Adhipati, as he had control over all the oceans and expanded his kingdom and responsible for renewing the grants to the many temples, conceiving and also constructing a huge temple complexes all over the southern part of the India. When we speak about the Hampi, we always very happy to note the large Vijay Vithala temple and the stone chariot, Krishna temple, or the great Virupaksha temple, which is the magnum opus of the Vijayanagara. Apart from these, we also look at the monolithic sculpture like the Narasimha, Lakshmi Narasimha, which is popularly called by the people Ugra Narasimha, which is wrong. Actually, it has to be identified as Lakshmi Narasimha, Sasve Kalu Ganapati and Kadale Kalu Ganapati. There are also the areas of the royal enclosures where we have the well-known Hazar Ramachandra temple and Mahanavami Dibba, where the Dasara celebrations used to take place. So the Hampi has been a very lucrative and very important religious center from much before the Vijayanagara dynasty established there. The crest deity of Hampi is Virupaksha, also known as Pampapati, and his wife Pampambika, the Parvati in the name of Pampambika. Even today, the local people have their names as Pampanna or Pampapati, Pampambika, Pampamma. All such names are quite popularly used by the local people. And Virupaksha happened to be the family deity for the large mass in the southern part of Karnataka and also the Bellari, Andhra region. So many people visit the temple and pay their obeisance. Hampi has also been an important center for the Kannada literature. The two doyens of the early Kannada literature like Harihara and Raghavanka lived there. The Harihara compiled a very important work called Girija Kalyana, which is on the line of Kalidasa's Kumara Sambhava. And subsequently, when the dynasty was established, the popularly known as Vijayanagara, through inscription, we hardly come across the name Vijayanagara dynasty. It is always called Karnataka Samrajya. So the Vijayanagara is a popular terminology which we have been using. So I would like to concentrate exclusively on the paintings that have been done in Hampi Virupaksha temple. The Maharangamantapa of Virupaksha temple has the ceiling paintings surviving till today. Naturally, as by the aging, the color pigments have gone, but still they are in a better condition to study and also understand their dating, their stylistic features and thematic compositions of the painting. So there are other examples, the references we find for the painting in Vijayanagara. The travelers who visited Hampi, like Abdul Razak, Nicholas Conti, Domingo Pace, etc., they refer to the painted houses, the painted streets in the Vijayanagara Hampi city. Nevertheless, there is also an important center of Vijayanagara murals at Lepakshi in Andhra Pradesh, Hindupur Taluk, and also district. So the Lepakshi Virbhadreshwara temple paintings date from 1540 onwards. So the ceiling paintings there and ceiling paintings at Hampi are the only surviving examples till the date of the Vijayanagara period. So let us look at the important historical consequences and also the paintings that are represented in Virupaksha temple. Let us see the temple plan. This is the temple plan. I derived it from the open sources, as it has already been published by well-known architects and also the scholars who have worked on Hampi. So the temple plan, you can notice that it is a two-tier cluster. The Rajagopura, which is popularly called today as a Bishtapaya Gopura. Of course, we also speak a little bit about the Bishtapaya. And a large courtyard entered by another small Gopura, which is supposed to be built by Krishna Devaraya in the year 1509. And when we enter into the second courtyard with the mantapas all around, and this is the Maharanga Mantapa, where you can see my cursor, and Sabha Mantapa, followed by a large Antarala and Garbhagraha, where the Virupaksha Linga resides. So this Maharanga Mantapa and the Raya Gopura, both these structures were built by Krishna Devaraya in the year 1509 to commemorate his coronation as the king. So it is a crystal clear from an inscription installed very next to Maharanga Mantapa. So the date of the Maharanga Mantapa becomes very clear through its historical epigraphical evidences. So now we look at the Gopura from inside as well as the outside. The Gopura oversees the large bazaar, popularly known as Virupaksha Bazaar, straight away stretching almost half a kilometer towards the Basavanna, the Nandi Mantapa facing opposite. And this is also Rathabidi. Rathabidi is the road where the annual chariot is taken by the large mass in a procession and celebrate the annual fair also. So the Rathabidi is a synonym with the Virupaksha Bazaar, which is now being renovated by the respective departments and trying to restructure the ancient Virupaksha Bazaar to its original shape and form. So the Shikhara, the popularly known as Bishtapaya Gopura, Bishtapaya Shikhara, Bishtapaya Rajagopura. So there are also very theories. I mean, recently some people have come up with various ideas about the Gopura was renovated, rebuilt, etc. But we go back to the historical consequences when the Gopura was already existing even before 1500. So the one which you see on the screen is the Gopura built by Krishnadevaraya in the 1509. So now we enter into the main courtyard where we have the Balipitas and Dhujasthamba, followed by a small Nandi Mantapa where there are three Nandis installed side by side, followed by a large Maharanga Mantapa with the Vedibandha on the top, where we have, there are beautiful stucco images representing various subjects and which we will see in the due course. So now we see the close-ups of the Maharanga Mantapa, which is a large pillared hall and following the lines of the Vithala temple hall in Hampi itself, where there are multiple small thin pillars, independent pillars, and also along with the valley as well as the lion representations, we can notice the interior of the Maharanga Mantapa. So the large hall having naturally a very large the ceiling. So the ceiling was covered with four layered paintings. You can see 1, 2, and this center mass as a 1, 3, and the lower mass as the 1, the fourth one. So, or even you can divide one more with the last piece where we have the procession of a saint or the pontiff. So, we will discuss one by one all these paintings and quickly look at the how the painting has been structured. So, when we look at the entire composition of the ceiling, so it has divided in various blocks, rectangular blocks, square blocks, and each block has, wherever there is a divinity that has been represented, each block is further decorated with an arch, further divided with the shrines on the top. So then on either side there will be a flanking figures. If it is Vishnu, there will be Garuda and Hanuman. If it is a Shiva, there will be Nandi and also Tumbura. So like that, we have all the images, the represented together with a proper, the shrine-like composition. So each shrine, each figure, wherever it is enshrined, it looks like a temple created for the figure. This is how the composition is planned. And the themes are very interesting. The themes representing the Trinity with their spouses, Vishnu with Lakshmi, Shiva with Parvati, and Brahma with Saraswati. You can see from here where my cursor is running, and these are the Trinities. The Trinity figures are towards the Navaranga hall. So these are towards the main hall of the temple. And followed by, we have Girija Kalyana episode, a large panel representing the wedding of Shiva and Parvati, which is attended by various divinities. And we see the close-up of all these pictures. And then followed by the Dikpalas, Ashta Dikpalas. And then there is a center flower, which is a projected flower, the Padma in the center, which is, you can also call it as a Lata Pattika with a square, beautiful decorative motifs all around. And on either side, we have Manmatha Vijaya panel. And also on the other end, there is a Tripurantaka Shiva. So then further, it has been represented with the Dashavatara panel. All the 10 avatars of Vishnu are represented. Interestingly, the Kalki is added here. Kalki is added with the sitting on the horse, which is a popular feature, iconographical details of the Kalki, which become very prominent after early medieval phase. And at the rear end of the panel, we have Rathi and Manmatha. Rathi and Manmatha are represented in very interesting format. Rathi is sitting on the horse. Horse is composed of the female figures, popularly known as the Panchanari Turaga, the five female figures composed in the form of a horse. So interestingly, and out, all outlines are beautifully demarcated here. And she is seated in Alida posture with the cane bow and also flower arrows. Similarly, opposite to her at the Kalki side, there is an image of Kama or Madana sitting on the elephant. So here elephant is made of nine women decorated, they are composed in the form of the elephant, so called as a Navanari Kunjara. Kama is also sitting in Alida posture with the cane bow and also the flower arrows. So this is the basic compositions we see here. And then there are three important compositions at the next level. So the one is from the top here, we have Rama breaking the Shivdhanas and the wedding of Rama and Sita. So the next episode is about the Arjuna shooting the arrow to Matsyayantra, looking at the bowl kept on the ground through the reflections. And Draupadi is also represented there as she is eagerly waiting for Arjuna to shoot and marry her. So this is the theme, especially the last one, Arjuna Matsyayantra, is a very popular theme. And we come across several number of such sculptures from the later Chalukya period onwards. And especially during the Hoysala period, we have plenty of such examples. And subsequently, there are three panels which represent the possibly the Mahabharata story. There are the chariots and also the riders, which of course has been identified differently by scholars. But identify them, the themes connected with the Mahabharata. The last one is the procession of the Yati. So I brief you now itself, the Yati procession has been identified as a procession of Vidyaranya as early as in 1937 by a scholar called P. Paramashivan. So after that, it has been followed as it is. C. Shivaramamurthy, well-known art historian, also identified it as a Vidyaranya's procession and also dated the painting to the 15th century. And of course, subsequently, another art historian like Stalak Ramrish also identified, followed the views of C. Shivaramamurthy. But as I mentioned to you in the beginning of my lecture, that the Mantapa was built only in the year 1509. So how the paintings can be dated to 15th century? 15th century means from 1400 to 1500. So the Mantapa was built in 1509. So the date the late C. Shivaramamurthy gave should be ruled out. So now we have to have a re-look at all the paintings very systematically, and also looking them not only from painterly quality, technically, and also from the stylistic point of view. So based on our arguments, based on our research, we can come to a conclusion about the date of painting and also other related issues. So here are the details of the first panel, where we see Vishnu and Lakshmi, Shiva and Parvati, followed by Brahma and Saraswati. I have individual representations of all these panels. We'll go one by one. The central panel detail and Girija Kalyana detail. I further have a much more detailed examples of all these. So this is the lower portion detail along with the Sri Rama and Sita wedding and also Arjuna episode. So here is the detail of the first sculpture, first figure. Vishnu with Lakshmi seated on one of the pita, very interesting pita with the arched decoration, which actually represents a torana, an arched torana decorated with Kirtimukha in the center. You can see a Kirtimukha in the center and followed by various figures seen in the small tiny the shrines painted on the upper portion. So the corners of the squares which we see here have the Vatapatra Shahi Krishna, and also a couple of figures which are much more destroyed, other rather corroded. We cannot identify them as they are very badly seen, but on either side it's a very clearly identifiable one example of Hanuman and also Garuda. Hanuman and Garuda are always associated with Vishnu. And the most interesting fact is, whenever the couple figure are represented in early Indian painting as well as the sculpture, the male figure is larger than the female figure. And especially in the traditions in the lower Deccan and the southern part of India, the female figure is always seated on the left lap of the male figure. This is the common features that we see in Indian art, especially the South Indian art. So here in the painting, we notice that Vishnu is seated on asana with Shankha and Chakra. He holds Lakshmi from the left arm, and whereas his right arm is in the Abhaya Hasta. So look at the Kirita, which is a typical of early Vijayanagara sculptures. So typical of early Vijayanagara sculpture, like a Karandaka Kirita, Karanda Mukuta type of Kirita, where it is like a box. So the round face, wide opened eyes, and the slenderous body, rhythmically designed structure of the image can be seen in these figures. So the tradition was, as I mentioned already there, I have another example from Lakshmi Narayana temple, Hosahodalu. It's of a Hoysala period. This temple was constructed between 1240 and 1250. And we also come across similar examples of the couple figure. Of course, from 10th century onwards, we have a tradition of couple figure representing in the same fashion. For the sake of the similarity, I have used the comparison with the sculpture here. And we have a Shiva and Parvati with all the retinue figures around. And you can also notice Shiva Parvati figure. It is from a place called Aralaguppe, dating to 10th century CE. So the tradition of the wife being represented on the left side and also partly sitting on lap, sometimes out of lap, but the Nandi will be part of the family. You can also notice Nandi here, Shiva and Parvati, and all the figures on the ceiling paintings are quite identical. Yeah, Brahma and Saraswati. Yeah, we have the similar example from a place called Kikkeri in Mandya district, in Kearpete Taluk, a temple called Brahmeshwara temple. It is named after a lady called Bommave there. But a similar iconic representations visually transformed when into painting, and it becomes almost identical even in the mode of representation. So now we have Tripurantaka figure, Tripura Samhara figure. Tripura Samhara is a most favored subject in the Indian painting, also Indian sculpture. So not only in the Vijayanagara, even in pre-Vijayanagara period, we come across plenty of examples of the Tripurasuras troubling the gods and goddesses and also the people on the earth, where they had a boon from Brahma that they would be killed by Shiva only when only they are together on particular day. So there's a beautiful narration in the Mahabharata, in Shalya Parva. Of course, the Tripura Samhara episodes are also narrated in various other texts, like Shupuran has a beautiful narration of this particular episode. But Mahabharata, particularly in Shalya Parva, Duryodhana goes to Shalya's place to request him to become a charioteer. Because the same day, Karna has to become the captain of the commander of the army. So Duryodhana praises Shalya and also induces him to become the charioteer to Karna, and compares Karna to that of Shiva as Tripurari, and Shalya as Brahma, so most intelligent charioteer. So nevertheless, the description what we come across in Mahabharata, you know, almost identically followed here. As we know that Mahabharata also has been rewritten in old Kannada by one of the well-known and most important scholar in Karnataka, Kumara Vyasa or Gadugina Narayanappa. So he wrote Kumara Vyasa Bharata, also known as Karnataka Bharata Kathamanjari. So even in the Shalya Parva, beautifully narrated, and the text, the work of Kumara Vyasa is almost contemporary to the paintings here. The work of Kumara Vyasa, I repeat, is very much contemporary to the paintings painted here. So I believe that the artist who painted these paintings had the first-hand knowledge of the literature, where he could conceive the every element of the literature into a visual description. So the Shiva with a white color, and the having multiple arms, and also having the Surya and Chandra as the wheels of the Ratha, and Saptashvas given by Surya, Brahma becoming charioteer, and Vishnu's serpent becoming the yoke of the Ratha. So three brothers are here represented in a circular form, and they are represented there. And you can also notice that Shiva is shooting the arrow towards the entangled three brothers. So the three brothers who were supposed to be the sons of Tarakasura, who was already killed by Shiva's son Kumara or Kartikeya. So they were the sons of Tarakasura were Vidyunmali, Kamalaksha, and Vindyaksha. So very interesting names, isn't it? So we have already a set pattern about the Tripurantakas in early Hoysala and late Hoysala sculptures. So both the sculptures come from 1240-1250 AD only. The upper one is from Javagallu, Narasimha Swami temple. The lower one is from Lakshmi Narayana temple, Hosahodalu. So my only interest is to how the visual narrative, how the visual elements transform from one medium to the other medium. There is also a strong belief. As we think today, the sculptors and painters were different. But in those days, it was not the case. The painters and the sculptors were one and all, and they were able to sculpt, and they were also able to paint. And probably the artists whom we are mentioning here in the early Chalukya to even in Ajanta also, we have similar examples. So from Ajanta onwards, in the subsequent period, we can see that artist and the term Kalavida or Chitra Kalavida also mean Shilpa Kalavida. They were acting as a both. So the professionalism and specialization started only in the post-colonial era. Before that, I think even artists like K. Venkatappa. So he always allowed to call himself as a Chitra, a Shilpa Chitra Kalavida, or Chitra Shilpi. So similarly, the Chitrakar or Chitra Kalavida would be same as Shilpa Kalavida also. So the tradition of showing the Tripurantakas or Tripuras in a circular form, as they are joined by a kind of a ring-like thing, and Shiva in a Ratha and shooting the three brothers in one arrow, already the image was set. And it was transforming into the different modes of representation in the subsequent period. So the Hampi panel, what we have seen, is a reminiscence and continuation of what we are looking right now on the screen. So now we have another very interesting episode of the very important episode of Manmatha Vijaya. Rati and Manmatha on their ratha, driven by parrot. Parrot was supposed to be their vehicle. So the Shiva, after Dakshayani's issue, he renounced the penance. So he was not ready to come up and the beautifully, even Kumarasambhava speaks about all these the stories. So the entire narration, what we see here, Shiva has already opened his eyes, and you can see the beautiful creepers, serpents, and also the landscape on the other side. And Nandi is here, and there is a beautiful figure of the Girija, the daughter of Himavant, and Himavant is also waiting eagerly to Shiva to open the eyes and also fall in love with Girija to marry her. So this episode is so beautifully conceived, and as a matter of fact, as the artist creating a kind of a landscape where this entire activity is set. Here is the water body with the fishes, we can see that, and followed by the ratha is being pulled by parrot, and he is in Alida posture, and you can also look at the way he is releasing the arrow. And Rati is eagerly, you know, watching all these activities, and I think the moment the arrow touches his body, the Shiva's penance was disturbed and he opened his eyes. So this particular episode always attracts the scholars to identify and also understand the narrative behind this particular subject. So then we have Girija Kalyana, subsequent representation. When Kama hit the arrow on Shiva fell in love with Girija, then the marriage take place. So Girija Kalyana is one of the most interesting narrative that has also been represented from early Indian art. Probably some of the finest sculptures we have in Elephanta Cave, followed by Yellora Dhumarlena Cave, cave number 29. And of course, there are also plenty of such examples in Yellora other caves. But even in early Chalukya, the Karnataka, early Chalukya Badami cave number one has a lintel panel representing the Girija Kalyana. And after that, there are plenty of examples of the Girija Kalyana in stone. But as far as the painting is concerned, this is one of the earliest example to be represented in the ceiling, even on the either on the wall. So we don't have any examples of the Girija Kalyana episode painted prior to this particular panel. So here you can notice that the panel is divided into five sections. The center is a magnum opus where Shiva and Parvati are represented. And you can also notice the Parvati's mother and father, and of course the entire retinue, entire family is represented where Brahma is a Purohita here. So the wedding is taking place in front of a tree. In front of a tree, the tree is identified as Shami Vraksha. Any auspicious holy functions take place. There is also saying called Shami Vraksha Pramanena. Shami Vraksha Pramanena, in the sense, the Shami is one of the most auspicious tree where even in the Virata Parva, the Pandavas kept their all weapons on the tree. It is also called Banni Mahankali. So it is associated with the Shakti Devata. And here the tree becomes witness for the marriage. And of course the Nandi. And if we look close up picture details of the Nandi, Nandi is eagerly looking top. You know, it's raised its head and looking the master's wedding. So all such minute details, you know, these type of details are never said in any iconographic books or iconographic treatise. It is all the artist who had a sense of, the contemporariness has been modified according to the necessity of the theme. So then we have the figures of Vishnu and followed by Lakshmi, and also the rishis who attend the marriage, like Tumbura is there, Narada is there, and on other side we also have Nandi. Nandishwara again represented in human form. So the Girija Kalyana, the detail of the Girija Kalyana, now you can have a look how the image has been represented, the flying figures on either sides of the arches, and also the Kirtimukha, which is commonly represented here. Exactly similar representation of the Girija Kalyana, a replication of the Girija Kalyana is represented on the Vedi portion of the Maharanga Mantapa. Here is a better example. You can have a comparison. So here is a Vrishabha Vahana is there, and also another form of Shiva is represented here. In the center, we have the Girija Kalyana. So these stucco images are the hallmarks of the Vijayanagara school of sculptures. As the most of the temples are built in granite, so the finest examples can only be seen in the stucco. Nevertheless, the granite sculptures are also very fine and nicely carved, but the finest examples where the artist can express not only form and content, but also the bhava, rasanubhava, can be had from the stucco figures. And you can also compare the contours of the stucco figures and the drawings of these paintings. They are almost identical. This is another clue which helps us to date the painting. So the painting and sculptures are contemporary and coeval. So now we go by Rama breaking Shivdhanas, followed by, again, Shami Vraksha is an example here. So Maharanga Mantapa, in the ceiling, we also have this particular example of Rama and Sita's wedding. More interestingly, you have double-headed bird, which is popularly called Ganda Berunda, but here it is used as the decorative motif. So there are also figures of the other brothers of Rama and who are attending the marriage, and followed by Arjuna Matsyayantra episode. So I have an example taken from Faisaleshwara temple, Halebidu, which is dated to 1121 CE. And almost after 300 years, this painting is done in the ceiling of Maharanga Mantapa, where Arjuna is represented. You can notice carefully the Matsyayantra, almost identical. And look at the figure of Draupadi. So curiously looking at the reflection and also trying to watch whether he is going to shoot or not. So that is how one can imagine all these themes. And one can notice the various figures seated on the lower strata, where the yatis and also the saints who witnessed the event. Then followed by the Ashtadikpalakas. So in my PPT, they are not in order, but I can tell you Yama, Agni, and Vayu. We also have Varuna. Varuna is in the next slide. Yeah, Varuna, Nairuti, Ishana, and Indra. So Dashavatara panel, as I mentioned in the beginning, right from Matsya to that of the Kalki, all avatars are represented here. And the corners of the Dashavatara panel, Rati with the Panchanari Turaga, Kama with the Navanari Kunjara. See, interestingly, these figures have been represented even in the sculptures. Sculptural representations. So it shows that sculpture and painting go hand in hand. The forms are also very much identical. And even in Dashavatara, we have similar examples represented plenty of times, even in the Vijayanagara temples in Hampi itself, and also elsewhere in the Vijayanagara region in that particular time. So the Panchanari Turaga and Navanari Kunjara becomes a kind of a repeated image even in the post-Vijayanagara period during the Mysore traditional painting and also in the traditional Tanjavuru painting style. These figures and forms become repetitive motifs that we see even in the later period. So then followed by Mahabharata episodes. I'm not going into these details as time is running out and would be coming back to a few figures to discuss. Yeah, you can notice. And it looks like a hunting scene and you have a tiger and you have a figures with a kind of a hat like, dress where these figures are seated in ratha at chariots and being pulled by the chariot, by the horses as well as the bulls. So what is important to understand is that in the background, these figures that have been represented with a long musketeer like form in the hand. I'm using the term musketeer because it has been said by some scholars earlier, but actually when we have a close up look at them, they are not musketeers. They are the long swords. They are the long swords which are carried by the soldiers. The dress what we see there also was once identified as the tiger spotted the dress which was used during the 18th 19th century of the Tipu and Hyder Ali and Tipu's period paintings. But when we compare with that type period's painting, we can hardly compare these examples with the paintings. So these paintings appears to be, these images appears to be created for the first time and represented. There are many such examples of hunting scenes, etc. Even in Hampi, there are plenty of examples one can see. Even in one of the foundations that is still intact in Mahanavami Dibba area, a series of hunting scenes are represented. Okay. So the followed by another example. And here is the most kind of a controversial for many scholars about the procession of the a pontiff or the saint. This is the episode which has been identified as that of the Vidyaranya, the founder, the royal preceptor and the one who initiated the foundation of the Vijayanagara dynasty through Harihara, Bukkaraya and his brothers. But some scholars also try to identify it as a Kriya Shakti, the one who was a very active person, the political person during the Vijayanagara period. But however, looking at the date of the Maharanga Mantapa and the important religious leaders during the time of Krishna Devaraya, it may be logically concluded the person in the procession is supposed to be Vyasatirtha, the one of the very important the pontiffs of the Dvaita philosophy and Madhva school, the fourth in the line of the Madhvacharya. So he was in Hampi at least from 1470s. He was in Hampi, and even during the time of the Salva Narasimha's rule. He was appointed and he also lived in Kanchipuram for almost a decade, and followed by his stay in Tirumala, Tirupati as a chief priest for almost 12 years. Then he comes back once again to Hampi and settles down there permanently. He established a school, or you can call it as a Ghatika Sthana, known as Vishwa Payonidhi. Vishwa Payonidhi was a, you can call it as a kind of a mini university or deemed to be university in contemporary context. He had a large number of students and also followers in the kingdom. So one of the poets and also one of the very important personality of the period, Somanatha, wrote a work called Vyasa Yogi Charita. Vyasa Yogi Charita is a kind of a elegy and historical sequences mixed together, and it speaks about the presence of Vyasa Tirtha and his important activities in Vijayanagara Hampi, and his role as a royal preceptor to Krishnadevaraya. Krishnadevaraya has given a good number of grants and which have been recorded in plenty of examples, the inscriptional evidences. So a place named after him as a Vyasa Samudra, Vyasanakere. So and also not only to Vyasa Tirtha, even his guru Brahmanya Tirtha, the grant was given, and the village near Bengaluru in Bengaluru, a place called Brahmanyapura, has been named after him, and locally it is being called Bomanipura. So the most important fact about Vyasa Tirtha was not only he was a Madhva saint, but the spearheading the Haridasa Sampradaya in Hampi. You can say, though the Haridasa Sampradaya was established by Narahari Tirtha, his predecessor, but as a matter of fact, when we look at the kind of a Haridasa Pantha revolution which took place during his period, under his auspices, with Purandaradasa and Kanakadasa, also followed by Vadiraja Tirtha, who was a pontiff of Udupi at Sonda Matha. So with all these evidences and activities, so he also was responsible in removing a bad omen on Krishnadevaraya. The many people call it as a myth, but whether it is a myth or fact, it has been recorded as he was responsible in removing the Kuha Yoga on particular day, and which he was successful in healing it out. And Krishnadevaraya takes a procession of his guru Vyasa Tirtha in Virupaksha Bazaar, and the Kanakabhisheka was performed on him. Possibly, I presume it could have been in Virupaksha Temple Maharanga Mantapa only, where this painting records the procession towards the Virupaksha Temple. Otherwise, artist would not have painted the Virupaksha and Pampambika with Nandi in this particular painting. So the procession, the figures in the procession have been identified and tried to identify by earlier scholars as that of the later images. But when we compare to the images of the contemporary period, historically, when we look at the painting, by the time these paintings were created, already we have the early examples of the paintings like Tutinama, Nimatnama, and also the paintings like Chaurapanchasika. And early Rajasthani school has already conceived and developed in the process of development. And also, more interestingly, the Mandu miniature paintings have already been done. So the tradition of using the pagadi and also the lion dress, you can call it as a pant like Ardhodaka, holding the long swords which look like the musketeers. So all these elements were already there in the painting as well as the sculptures. So the artists usually take the elements which have been seen and also which have been experienced. So the camel and the elephant which carrying the drums is also a symbol of the royalness that has been bestowed upon or given upon the pontiff. The pontiff sitting in the open palanquin, wearing the vastra on his head. This is the system. The all pontiffs do not keep their head open. Do not keep their head open. They always cover their head with the uttariya. So, which is the natural form. We can also see a detail of the example. Yeah, here is the more close-up example where he holds a piece of a thread-like thing. There is a bell in the center, which is not visible clearly here. Sitting on the palanquin, carried by two persons in the front and back. So he is in Chin Mudra. The Yati is in Chin Mudra and covering his head. covering his head with the uttariya, the long uttariya. So there is also attempt by some scholars to identify this figure, whether it could be a woman. So if it is a woman, it could not have been like this. It could have been represented like a woman itself. So anyway, in that way, we may also keep on imagining and also arguing about the things. But keeping in mind all available possible evidences and making the stylistic analysis of these figures, one can conclude that these figures neither fit in 17th century or 18th century or even 19th century. So there is a clear-cut indication of the contemporariness that can be associated with the contemporary stucco figures and also sculptures. Based on these Hampi mural paintings, established as the model to the succeeding period, the mural tradition painting, as we see in the case of the later paintings at Hiriyuru in Chitradurga district, followed by Shibi in Tumkur district, and also the paintings in Mysuru. So Mysuru Shweta Varaha Swami temple, Prasanna Krishna temple, and also the Prasanna Venkatramana Swami temple. The tradition continued and culminated into the what we today call Mysuru traditional painting, and also another school which emerged from Vijayanagara school is that of the Tanjavuru tradition and also Surupura painting. So with this note, I conclude my talk, and also I would like to thank you. Please subscribe the channel and support, and also if you have any queries, you can write me email. The email is there in the beginning. With this note, I thank you. I close the lecture.